panel. And today we're joined by the German dance scene pioneer, DJ Hell. How are you today, mate?
I'm good. It's pretty hot here in London, not the usual weather, but I'm okay, thank you.
Great stuff. Yeah, it's a nice bit of air conditioning in here, actually, which we're quite thankful for.
Here it's quite chilly. It's pretty cold, but upstairs it's like 32 degrees Celsius, and that's like Miami or Ibiza.
So we're going to talk about your new album, Zukunfts Music.
Future Music. Yeah.
Did I say it right?
Zukunfts
Music.
Not bad. Zukunftsmusik.
Zukunftsmusik.
Very German, sounding spelling, yeah.
But first, just want to talk a bit about your history, because you started off DJing quite a while ago when you were playing things like hip hop and ska and punk before sort of house music was a thing. But what was it that first got you into or attracted you about house music and then techno in the late 80s?
Yeah, you're right. I started playing records. I didn't call myself a DJ. It was like playing records in front of your friends and friends of the friends. But it became kind of professional already in the early stage when I was 20, because I had like a contract with a club near Munich, and I played there every weekend. I mean, it was not much of a DJ fee. The money I got from DJing, I was investing in new records, you know. That was really very important to me, to have always the newest stuff. And I went already that time, when in the late 70s, early 80s, I always fly over to London to buy the new records, and went to Black Market and all these record shops. And I even went to the record companies. I remember a guy called Dave Durrell. He was a manager of some of the techno, the early acid house dance labels, and I somehow got a meeting with him in his office, and I said, Dave, I need all these promos and you know, before everybody has it, and you have to give me all the white labels and stuff. And I went to the Soul to Soul people and asked them about the promos, and because I need all that stuff before it's released. So it was pretty much crazy. I just went there and I said, I'm a DJ from Germany, I need all this new records. So I came back with like 50-100 records, with a big box of new records. And that time there was no internet or no, you have to go to London to buy the records. And I was pretty much ahead of the time when I went back to Germany and played all this unreleased music. It was quite, that's how I started to be a DJ, and still doing it with nearly 55 years.
Wow, yeah. And you got big into house and techno, obviously, and then you're kind of what really set you on your way, I guess, was your track My Definition of House Music, which was quite banging at the time, wasn't it? It's quite fast and pumping.
Yeah, it's called it's My Definition of House Music, and at that time Underground Resistance was pretty much a big influence to me. So I used the rhythm structure of old Underground Resistance record. I reproduced it, and I used cellos, sound of a cello that time, and like special piano sound design. And it was quite unusual to combine all this kind of ideas, concepts, rhythm parts, and so. But that was my first record in 1992, and it was released on RNS Records in Belgium. And that time, RNS was the leading techno label in the world. So it brings me inside the scene and well known, and it was a quite big success, my first record. So that was the start for more like an international attention.
And I was just talking to you before that I first met you about 1994 or 5 at the Ultraschall in Munich, which was the club that was kind of next door to the old Munich airport, where the tribal gathering parties were.
Amazing.
Also at that time.
I'm sorry, I can't remember where we met, but
I can barely remember it. But it was when you did the X-Mix compilation, which was quite a big thing at the time, I suppose, as well. It was quite a big profile thing.
It was very profiling, because they had this video concept on the side. So they were doing a lot of kind of modern, that time, modern video animation together with the music, and sold, I think they sold a CD, a video VHS cassette and a CD maybe. And it was like a unique packaging, and they were always the best or you know, most innovative DJs nominated for mixing the series, and I was doing the fifth one, I think, and but I can't remember that we met at
it was a crazy
Ultra Show. Yeah.
But then, yeah, it seems like you moved around quite a bit in the 1990s, but then why did you decide to move to Berlin in the late 90s?
I was living in Berlin before that in 1993. Oh. Because, oh wow, some people arriving. Okay, hello. Customers, okay. In 1993, I was working in a record shop called Hardwix. And I was buying and selling records, and that was my first time in Berlin, where I was living there, DJing already in the nightclubs called the nightclubs that time was called Planet, and another club was called famous Tresor, still around, and another club was called Ewerk, and that was the blueprint for all Berlin nightlife clubs and the nightlife culture. What we are thinking now, you know. So I was there already, and then I moved to New York, and then I was DJing there at the Limelight. It was a church, and I was resident DJ there with another guy called Jeff Mills.
I've heard of him.
I heard of him, okay, for 1 year. So, and then I thought, okay, it's time to go back to Munich, and then I was in Munich, I did the X-Mix, I started my own label, Gigolo Records, in late 96, 97, early 97. And then, you know, I did my second album, continued DJing, taking care of the label, Gigolo Records. You know, and get some attention with Gigolo Records quite early.
Well, yeah, I was going to say, just around the time of the millennium or whatever, Gigolos became almost synonymous with the emerging electroclash scene, didn't it? How did it kind of become in more of a sort of electro-y label?
I was traveling the world at that time already, and I had met so many people with so many great ideas and concepts, and they gave me music all the time. And I was working in another company in the early 90s, in Frankfurt, called Logic Records, and their main act was a famous group called Snap. So I learned how to do the music business, or how to work in the music business, and then I said in early 90s, I will never run my own business. And I'm a DJ, I'm a producer, I'm an artist, but I will never run my own record label. And that changed, you know, after years. So I got good music material from Australian guys, from Japanese guys, from American people, from all over Europe. So it was time to start your own business and get serious about it. And but I said, I only gonna do it, two people, I only gonna do it if I run it in my way, and I don't accept the rules of the music business. I will just follow my own rules and do it the way I want it. That's the only way I can do it. So that was late 96, early 97. And then I think the first record was a guy from Berlin. And I think the third record was already Jeff Mills. It was a 12-inch called Shifty Disco, because he always played some disco tracks in his techno set. And I said, Jeff, you know, I have to release it. I know you don't want to release it on Axis or other labels you're running. I'm happy to release it, you know, on Gigolo. And he said, okay, do it. And we signed like a one-sided simple deal. And that, you know, after the Jeff Mills release, I had a lot of attention. And then the fourth release was I'm a disco dancer and a sweet romancer from Christopher Just. And then there was already Zombie Nation. Cairncroft 400, and then that track went number two in the official UK top 10. And
I think it was number one.
No, it was number two. I don't know what was number one. There was some other. And from that on, there was no way back. It was exploding. It was exploding, and then there's this Electro Clash hype coming up, and it was really mostly out of control, the whole thing. You know, I couldn't control it anymore.
How did you find Fischer Spooner?
I was living in New York, and I didn't know them because they were connected with people from a so-called Deutsche Gallery. They were more performing in museums and galleries, and they were not connected with the electronic music scene. So they sent me like photos, videos, music to Munich that time, and I checked it, and I was thinking, that's kind of freaky the way they look and the way they perform, but it's kind of artistical. And the truth is, I didn't like the music in the beginning, and there was Emerge and other songs, and I was like, yeah, that's okay, but not like top level. But then I changed my mind and I said, let's release it, you know, and do some remixes, and then Emerge was released, and then we did a new video for it, and I invested a lot of money in the band, and they were coming over to Berlin and performed, and everybody liked it immediately because of their live performance and because of their different way of seeing or doing their thing. You know, it was I learned a lot from the people of Fischer Spooner, how to create something special and how to make it look like big.
Emerge though it sounded really like IF, Space Invaders of Smoking Cross.
There was the same time. I mean, it was released on another label called Disco B, and I was doing A&R for them before I stopped my own label, because also I was fed up with their system, because I thought that's not my way to do to go, and I will change everything. And when I start Chigurlo, I also said, because there was no digital music, there was no MP3s, there was only vinyl and CD, and even CD was not really accepted. So I said, we don't do any promotion, we're not gonna send out anything to the DJs. If you wanna have it, you have to go to the shop and buy it. But I couldn't hold that. I mean, that concept changed immediately after 2 years. And then around 2000, I said, okay, now this is the new concept. I call it the terror promotion. We're gonna promote everything as hard as possible. So we're gonna hire promotion agency in Barcelona, in London, in Paris, in Berlin, and in America and all around the world, and push the music because it's for the artists, and I really want that music getting heard, and you know, pushing the artists, and invest some money in that. So I changed that idea, and yeah, it was not a bad idea, I think.
That was the other time I met you before, was when you were DJing with Fischer Spooner in London.
True. But that time we already sold it to Ministry of Sound. Yeah. And they were praying or hoping that it's going to be number one or top 10. But it wasn't. So we had a live show here, I think on 2 days, two shows with Fischer Spooner, and the press were really critical about it. Because they said it's all playback, it's just a show going on, nobody plays live. But I think it was Face Magazine or Melody Maker. I think nobody really liked it. And it was top 40 maybe, but not like a top 10 single. And I think Ministry immediately sold it to another company, and I even can't remember what company it was.
There was real hype around them at the time, wasn't
it? It was big hype. They were on every cover, and they were unstoppable. I mean, the hype was like out of control. They followed us. We were on a European tour, and the A&R managers and even owner of the record companies, they followed us to the hotels, you know, they followed us to the restaurants, and everybody wants to have Fischer Spooner signed. And the final signing moment was when Ministry said to Warren and Casey, Warren is the producer, Casey was the singer. We gonna bring you over from London to Paris to London with like the Concorde in the morning, and at night you're gonna fly back to New York. They did that, and they really liked that idea. You know, it was kind of crazy flying in the morning from New York to Paris with the Concorde, then go to Heathrow, sign the contract. I don't know how many money was involved. I was not involved anymore. And then go back to London at night.
It was
To New York, sorry.
It was rumored to be a million or a million and a half, wasn't it?
Hmm?
It was rumored that it was £1 million or a million and a half.
I think it was much more. That's what I heard. I think it was nearly double. But the stupid thing
is, you didn't get any of that.
I was not involved anymore because that was the deal from the beginning, that I'm going to help them to get successful and push it as much as I can. And that's it. You know, that's why they gave me their album for free. But I invest a lot in their shows and the videos and not in the costumes, but I really support them. And I knew they want, because the band invested a lot of money themselves already to come close to a major record deal. And they said that from the beginning. So to me, it was cool not be involved. I mean, I didn't lose money, but I didn't win money. So for me, it was a good situation, because with Fisher Spooner, we got so many attention. And they become friends, you know, and I learned from them how to do it in the American way. I'm glad that I did it. Some other people would not do it because there's no profit, but I thought there's other much more profit beside of the money, you know. So I still think the same way.
Because you also released around that time stuff by Tiga, Miss Kitten and the Hacker, yeah, and Vitalik, who was making electro-y stuff at the time. And there was this whole kind of, there was an electroclash like scene in Berlin, wasn't there? It was a real like where fashion met electro,
exactly,
and glamour.
Fashion was a big part of the whole electroclash thing, because fashion was really not allowed into the techno scene. It was really like, we not interested. We don't want to connect with that area, with their people. And also, we don't want to connect with the art world. And Gigolo was always connecting with everybody, with the art world, with the fashion world, with the movie world, with everything you can think about it, you know. We always try to break the rules and do it in a different way. But for my understanding, till today, there was art, music, fashion, and movies, and it was always one thing, you know. And even, you know, I couldn't separate it. So for me, the other people were missing something. So, you know, 2017, a lot of people realized that it's one thing, you know, and I was on the right tip, you know. I think so.
Because in a sense, it was almost some of it a bit like punk as well, because people would be like, oh, I'm not really a producer or in a band, but I'm just going to have a go anyway.
Yeah.
And some of the stuff was quite simplistic in the makeup of it, but it was very DIY.
Just do it, you know, and see what's happening. And most important thing, if I think about Gigolo, the crazy years, I didn't make any compromise, because I always said to myself, if you compromise in any direction, this will be the beginning of the end. So I never did.
And it was around 2002, it was the most exciting thing in dance music, wasn't it?
It was amazing, you know. It was all we re-released the numbers of names, first techno record ever, Charivari. Then I went to New York again, signed Bobby Condors for his like great style of house music, because he said, I gonna do this house music one time and then it's done, you know. And he did some amazing records like The Poem or Acid. So this Acid, I can't remember the track, Acid something. And then I signed Doppler Effect from Detroit. Then we have people like Mount Sims, Crossover, and bands like Crack We Are Rock from the States. And if I see all the 300 releases, a lot of people are not in business anymore. And I really lost contact as well. But a lot of people went very famous, like Vitalik and Fisher Spooner and Tiger and Miss Kitty and who else? Oliver Huntemann. I don't know. There's so many people. And now we are like running into 20 years and I'm doing a lot of parties. We started the Sonar Festival with the first anniversary, and in July we're gonna do 2 weeks. I know at the second week of July we're gonna do 4 days festival in Berlin, showing like gigolo artists and the music at the famous Tresor Club.
Cool, sounds good. Why do you think Electroclash kind of dropped off after a while?
I remember exactly that most of the artists I work with said, we are not Electroclash anymore. We don't want to be part of this scene. We hate it so much, you know. Suddenly, people like Peaches were Electroclash. I remember some rock bands like, can't remember their name, famous English rock bands. Suddenly were, everything was Electroclash, you know. So it was kind of confusing. And then there was a lot of people try to suck out the money of that big thing. And I remember on the highest point around 2002, I released a record from a band called The Twins. And I didn't know they're German. I thought they're Italian. But it sounded kind of Depeche Mode, EBM music. And I said to everybody, this is the last record in this kind of direction. And I'm gonna change and I'm gonna move on in another direction, because around 2002, there was a big wave of new music coming out of New York with DFA, with LCD Sound System and Rapture. And I went back to New York and I said, this is the new direction I'm gonna follow with Gigolo. And I think on the highest point around 2001, 2002, I said, that's it for me. I'm not gonna release stuff sounding like Electroclash or going in that direction anymore. That's done for me, you know. And I'm not interested in the fame or money or selling a lot of records. I want to move on and step into the next thing, you know, musical direction.
But you had some fun parties around that time, yeah?
We had some amazing parties all around the world, even in London. I remember in the second floor there was Pet Shop Boys playing. And we had some production of KLF. The band was from London, was called Atomizer. Yeah. And their single was Hooked on Radiation. And it sounded completely like KLF because it was produced by Jimmy Cordy. And I was really happy when he did the song. And I think we had a free remix from the Pet Shop Boys on the B-side because they liked it so much and they were pretty much big fans of it, and even willing to DJ in a second floor at the Gigolo night here in London. I remember one party, especially it was at the Sonar in Barcelona. Can't remember the year exactly, but there was FX Twin was there, Jeff Mills, everybody. It was a Sunday night at the Moo Club, and it was so out of control. The whole club went crazy, and I was DJing, and I had a cut here in my arm. You can still see the scarves, and it was a lot of blood, and it didn't stop running. And I was it was all running into the DJ mixer, and I really didn't know where it comes from. But everybody was jumping around like totally out of control, and I maybe pushed somebody or anything, and I said, I need to stop DJing because it's not, you know, the blood's running out and it's not stopping. And then I went to the toilet and I couldn't stop it. And then somebody told me near the Moo Club there's a hospital. So I went to the hospital and I said, you need to take care of that. And then I found out that I'm not the only one in the hospital from my party. You know, there is already there was a girl, she had like a cut here on the eye, and she needs to have like 4 or 5 stitches here. And there was another guy, he had opened his feet, and I was laying there in the hospital and I saw this is too far, you know, this I can't go further. It's like I need to stop that. And because what's will be the next thing, you know, at a party. I don't want that anybody get hurt, you know, but it was really out of control because people went so crazy. It was so enthusiastic. They were jumping and screaming and losing their mind because of the music, you know, and I remember exactly that moment. So I said to the club, to the Mew Club, we're gonna stop this, you know, this is, I can't control it anymore. I'm hurt, you know, other people were hurt, so let's gonna stop that. They never booked me again. I mean, so that was like 15 years ago.
but then after the Electroclash thing, you kind of changed direction with Gigolos, and it's carried on ever since. And you've also been carried on making music. You've collaborated with people like Brian Ferry, Billy Ray Martin, James Murphy, P. Diddy. Yeah. Why did you like seeking out varied collaborators?
I think that's the essence of an artist. You always try out new things and work with people you like or do something unexpected. I remember when I worked with Puff Daddy, everybody started hating me, you know, till today, yeah, because they said Puffy is, you can't, you know, bring him inside Gigolo. And there was a group from England called the Fat Truckers, and they did an amazing song called Superbike. And it was, I was thinking that's the new thing, you know, that it was sounding like Suicide, Alan Vega, and it was played at some festivals and parties, and people totally freaked out. And I signed the single and the album, and I remember the singer of the group called me and said, "Hell, we need to talk, you know. We don't like this Puffy thing, you know. We can't release on the same label like Puff Daddy." But I signed them already, but that was the last thing. But he said, "This is not, we can't do that, you know. We don't want to be releasing our music." I mean, I released it already. That was too late to stop it. But they really hate the Puffy thing. And until today, there is people complaining that I worked with Puff Daddy. They don't complain about Brian Ferry, but the Puffy thing, they missed it, you know. And after all these years, I'm really happy to work with Puff Daddy, and I learned.
he got very into electronic music himself, didn't he?
He was there before all the black community was there. In like the early, around 2002, he went to Ibiza and after hour places and techno parties, and he really liked it. And then he did a song called "Let's Get Ill," featuring Kelis, and that was, for me, it was a revolution. It was groundbreaking. It was well done. And so many stories, who was behind it, who was in the studio when it happened. And "Let's Get Ill" was, for me, it was like a revolution. It was, you know, a guy like Puff Daddy is doing a great techno track featuring Kelis. It was, and I said to Universal, because he was signed on Universal, and I said to Universal Germany, "If you need some help for the German market, I'm willing to help. You know, I'm doing some remixes and stuff." So, and then I was in New York, and I went to Bad Boy, to the building, Bad Boy Recordings, I think was the name of Puffy's label, and I said, "I'm a DJ from Germany, and I want to work with Puffy," and I left my CD there, and because I was producing album called New York Muscle in 2004 in New York, and I never thought he gonna listen to it, you know, because he was not at the office. I gave it to some music manager, and the next day he called me, and I was inside the aircraft going back to Germany, and the phone was ringing, and I picked it up. It was shortly before takeoff, and the stewardess said, "You need to shut down your phone, you know, we're gonna leave now." And I said, I really remember that well. I said, "I can't shut down the phone. This is the $1 million call." It's Puff Daddy. And she said, you know, shut, you know, she didn't believe it. So, but I said to him on the phone quickly, "I come back next week if you need me in the studio," and I did. And so that was the beginning of a great friendship and partnership. And I did some remixes for him, and I really liked the way he was working and motivating people, and the way he sees the world. And he's, you know, successful in all direction. Everything he's touching, he was like really making a big noise and stuff in it. I even misunderstand the Puffy concept completely, because he was always, when he was in front of a camera, he was always like showing off and playing the big guy, but in real life he's a great guy, you know, he's just manipulating the media. And I was believing, you know, that he's maybe a kind of freaky guy, but he's not. He's very highly professional, and I really like the way he works and the way he treats me and other people. It was really amazing, really amazing.
How did you get the permission of the Tom of Finland people to do the that video?
Oh,
wow,
so many stories. Yeah. Yeah, that was the first single of my new album, Zukunftsmusik, I Want You. And I always had this idea and concept in my brain to animate the paintings of Tom of Finland for, you know, showing it at the, we call it a short movie. It's also a video. And the funny thing is, I was nominated as best music video in a festival in Germany, and I won a second prize for it. And I always had this idea that this gay kind of look, gay culture, you know, needs to be more combined with my music, because all my doing as a DJ and a producer, and you know, it's all based on gay culture and early club culture, and I just pay respect to that. And but I'm not gay. I always loved Tom of Finland, you know. It's, even if you're not gay, you can like it. And I went to LA and went to the Tom of Finland Foundation last year and asked them if they are interested in a cooperation. And I said, I'm gonna use any picture Tom painted in his life, and I'm gonna create a short movie. And then I'm gonna present it to you, and if you like it, this is gonna be my new single. And I think right now I have like around 800,000 clicks on YouTube, and it's quite surprising, and it gets a lot of attention, and I'm very happy for that.
So your new album, Zukunftsmusik, translates as music of the future. Tell us a bit about the rest of it.
Yeah, the name came pretty late when I was finished already, because I was really crazy not finding the perfect title for the music, because normally when you do music in a studio, it comes automatically. Suddenly somebody says anything, or you have the idea, and then you know exactly that's the title. And but with my last album, I couldn't find a perfect title. So one day I was looking into old papers and old like concepts I write down, and then I found the name, and I thought I already have it. So I mean, it's music for the near future, but it also is connected with the past, because I was using a lot of analog gear and concepts from the past, from bands like David Bowie, bands like Kraftwerk, and also song structure and from David Bowie. And he was a big influence to that album as well, because most of the tracks are not, you know, regular DJ music. So, but that's why I do a lot of remixes now. So it's music from the future, but also connected with the past. You know, you can't cut out their history at the past. So that's...
I was going to say, mentioning David Bowie, if you are David Bowie, is this your low?
Thank you. Why not? Yeah. The thing was, okay, next story. I was trying to connect with him like 2 years ago, and I knew that the ex-girlfriend from Iggy Pop, when they were living in Germany, in Berlin, were still connected with him, because she was a photographer, and she released a photo book about the time in Berlin with Iggy Pop and David Bowie with the German publishing company. And I know the publisher, and he connect me with that lady, and I said, I'm gonna send you the song, and you're gonna email it to Mr. David Bowie. And I sent it to her, and she said she will not send it to him because it sounds too much like Bowie. And I thought, I take it as a plus, you know. So let's talk in person, let's talk directly, and then I will explain you why it sounds like that, and then you hopefully will gonna send it to New York to Bowie. And 2 weeks later, before I met her, the Debbie Bowie died. So I thought I can't release that title on my album anymore because it was made for him. And I was hoping if he's gonna hear it, he will maybe like it or hopefully like it and gonna jump on it. A track is called Army of Strangers, and so I released it and I used another singer and I wrote the lyrics, and I think it's one of the strongest tracks on the album, but it's very cineartic, very orchestral, and it is not like my regular DJ music. It's very much big inspired by Mr. David Bowie.
I was a big Bowie fan as well, and okay. Yeah, it's very very sad when he died. But yep. What else have you been up to lately?
I'm promoting the album as heavy as it needs. So there's a lot of remixes coming out. I was at the Sonar Festival promoting the album, but also doing this anniversary of 20 years of Gigolo. It's at the same time, but I don't care. So there was one remix from Phil Kieran from my new single called Car, Car, Car. It drives you near or far. Okay, that's the lyric. So it was played by everybody, and I was really surprised. Phil Kieran did a remix called Autobahn Mix, and it's a song sounding very like Kraftwerk in the 80s, but it was really kind of 92 beats per minute, and Phil Kieran changed it into a DJ track, but he really kept the original flavor and sounds. And so now, I think it was one of the most played tracks at the Sonar Festival. Everybody played it. Innovision, Manu Litov, myself, and other people. I heard, you know, people report to you. So I'm presenting the album, promote it, doing a tour all around the world, and pushing out the remixes. Solomon did the remix for the next single called Anything Anytime, and I don't want to, you know, that it's going to be misunderstood that people listen to it and think this is, you know, I'm not involved in club music or club culture anymore. I think with all the remixes, it will be 3 times more remixes than the album, up to 50 remixes I have already, a lot of great stuff, and that's really focused on DJ music and DJ culture.
What do you still love about DJ culture and electronic music?
That's my life, you know. I will be a DJ the rest of my life. I know that. I mean, maybe not traveling as heavy as I do now, but there's so many things you can do as a DJ and as a label owner and as a producer and a remixer. And I also do music for fashion shows. And I always thought about to do my own radio show. And, you know, now it's the Chinese market. I have kind of connection with them, and I found a guy who is allowed to play electronic music on the radio, because in China it's all regulated and limited. So I maybe connect there with the radio station and play some of my music and Gigolo music, and a lot of things to do, you know, and it's a lot of concepts. I try to step into new ground and new ideas I never touched. So there's a lot of things I never did. There's a lot of things to do.
Cool, brilliant. Well, it's been great chatting to you today.
Thank you. Hel,
thanks very much.
A lot of stories. Thank you.